careful the media can be.
It can be difficult. I mean, to me, he's a remarkable talent. On the other hand, he's got a big advantage George Best didn't have, and he's got what happened to George to look at, and what happened to Bobby Charlton. And it's really his decision whether he wants to be the George Best or the Bobby Charlton of the future. My advice, simply, and I'm sure yours would be the same, Terry, would be that the next 10 years he should be a footballer, because that 10 years is going to flash by anyway, and then he's got the rest of his life to worry about, and not feel he's got to cram an entire lifetime into the next decade.
Yes, and his good advice. I'm sure he's listening to it. Is there a potential in a Gaza film?
Oh, I would have thought so. I'd be very surprised if he hasn't already had a dozen offers.
Because really, it's... I know you never liked the Rambo kind of movie, because it's not really what I saw you were defined in one of the papers. You were saying that you like a story that's about people, not necessarily heroes, who preserve their integrity in the face of sometimes insurmountable odds.
That's absolutely true. I think that life, more so nowadays than ever before, offers all sorts of options and all sorts of temptations, all sorts of difficulties. And I've always been enormously drawn to men and women who took those odds on, who didn't duck, who didn't, as it were, become non-persons, but took the odds on and somehow came through and with their integrity intact.
Where does that differ from, say, the Rambo kind of movie?
Because I think it acknowledges that life's difficult. And the Rambo type of movie gives you the impression that life can be remarkably simple, that if you've got enough muscles and a big enough machine gun, or big enough with anything, that you can succeed. That you can succeed and overcome. And life actually is very difficult. Being a human being is extremely tough, and getting through life can be very difficult. And I think that films, if they can acknowledge that, and at the same time convince the audience at the end that, in fact, it can be fulfilling and you can have a remarkable life, that must offer people some hope for the future.
It was interesting that the BBC used Local Hero, the theme from Local Hero, for Paul Gascoigne's compilation.
It was in the half-time during the World Cup. It was one of the most marvellous documentary compilations I've ever seen. Whoever did it should really win.
And of course, Local Hero. Is that your favourite movie that you made?
Yeah.
I think it might be mine as well.
It's a lovely, gentle film, and it also is about a world that I'd certainly like to inhabit. You know, that's a nice world.
Well, it's good to see you back now, putting your name on a film after the, well, what would we call the hiatus in Hollywood?
Hiatus.
Yeah. The new film is called Memphis Belle. I saw it today. And it's set in World War II. It's about a bomber crew. Now, do you think there's an audience for a World War II film?
I'll find out next weekend. I mean, there absolutely is, because we've now screened it for enough audiences to know that the audiences love it, particularly women, which was kind of a surprise for all of us.
They're still interested in the period.
Well, it's not that. I think it's a question of identity. Audiences identify totally with the characters in the film and the crisis they go through. And we had a most extraordinary statistic in America. 83% of women who saw the film loved it, didn't like it, loved it. And that's unprecedented.
Now, the thing is, it's about the Memphis Belle, a bomber, an American bomber with an American crew based in Britain. I know you would have preferred to have made it about a British bomber.
I would.
Based in Britain, but why didn't you?
It's a kind of an abiding sadness, basically, because the film cost $23 million. It has an enormous amount of special effects. It's a very expensive film to mount, and there's a huge amount on the screen. And you could never raise that kind of money on a British story about a British bomber crew. And it's a kind of tragedy, really.
It's a digression before we see a little bit. In the movie business, particularly Hollywood attitudes, when you have had what they might perceive as a failure in Hollywood, how did you find it possible to raise the money on your name to make another movie?
Because they didn't see it as a failure. I think that what Hollywood saw was I was asked to do something which probably wasn't doable. I was silly enough to give it a go. And I think I failed honourably. I mean, I don't think anyone has ever accused me of failing dishonourably or not having tried. God knows I tried. And I think that the world loves a trier, you know?
Yeah. Let's see a little bit of this Memphis Belle.
He's coming around again. Jack, get the greedy bastard.
They're going after the first flight.
Windy City's on fire.
Why don't they do something?
Come on, bail out, you guys.
Come on, wake up. Get out.
Jesus, there's a hole in the pilot's window.
It's an extraordinary story of Well, when those kind of movies were made in black and white, the thing that struck me is you always had, say, Gary Cooper or a fella, a middle-aged actor. Every one of these actors looked as if they were about 18 years of age.
Well, they were.
And some of them, you felt their voices hadn't even broken.
Well, in the case of one of them, it's true. I mean, Gazza on a B-17 during the war would have been one of the older members of the crew.
At 23.
Seriously. The average age of the airmen was 19. The average age of the captains was 22. They were children. And I think that's the point that the film makes very,
very
well.
The thing that came across to me more than anything was how young they were. And they said, well, wait a minute, that's not the way we expected it to be.
No. But it's a true story, and these boys were massively courageous. I mean, they were absolutely extraordinary. It's hard to know how we or you or I would react today, given the problems and challenges they were.
It's a B-17 on bombing runs over Germany.
It's 24 hours in the life of a bomber crew.
And the interplay of the characters, which I thought was most interesting. I mean, the effects are terrific. Did I read somewhere that there was only, without ruining the movie, I mean, there's supposed to be hundreds, thousands of these bombers, but you'd only got about three of them, hadn't you? Five bombers. How'd you turn them into thousands?
It's all movie magic. It's worth seeing the film just to see that. I mean, it does look like hundreds and hundreds of bombers, but it was difficult. With great difficulty is the answer.
Yeah.
No, I'm very proud of the film. It's an enormously difficult film to make. I don't think any of us who started it realised what we're letting ourselves in for. And it works. It's very emotional. People cry. That's, I suppose, what cinema's supposed to do.
We won't give away the ending, because the ending is crucial. But, I mean, the actors in the film, as I said, were very young. They were also, with the exception of Matthew Modine, pretty well unknown.
Yeah.
Was that deliberate?
It had to be, because once we decided it was going to be an ensemble cast where all 10 members of the crew were kind of equally important, you can't have a film where one of them, or two of them for that matter, are major stars that you have to keep cutting to, because it will unbalance the movie. And Matthew particularly was wonderfully honest about that and said, look, this is what this film's about. Make it about that. Don't pander to me.
Did you mean, but no, do you have a thing anyway about making films with big stars? I know you used De Niro in The Mission.
It's my belief that what audiences really fall in love with is a story and with people they believe in. And I don't think they mind whether the person they believe in is a star or not. And therefore, if they can see someone who they absolutely accept, Midnight Express is a good example, no one ever questioned that boy was Billy Hayes. If that part had been played by a Dustin Hoffman or any other wonderful actor, they bring with them the baggage of the other movie. So you're always looking at Tootsie, or in the case of Robert Redford, you're looking at the guy from Out of Africa. So I've always believed that if you're going for credibility and you're telling a true story, you're better off to have an actor who the audience don't immediately identify with another role.
Hmm. Were there any parallels, or have there been parallels drawn in America when you've been there, or even here, with the young men, the 19-year-olds, as they did in Vietnam, going off to the Gulf now and possibly to fight and die in the
very
desert?
Much so, because I think that you have to go back as far as 1943 to find a situation where everyone understood what the war was about. They understood why they were going to war, they understood what was being asked of them, and although they were hugely courageous, there was no questions in their mind. They were relatively unquestioning. We've now dealt, since then, with 40 years of tremendous ambiguity. I've never understood what the Korean War was about. A lot of people to this day have never been able to justify the Vietnam War. Here again in the Gulf, we at least understand the issues. And we understand that it's an important issue, and I think that people in the Gulf, they may not want to be there, God knows, and I hope that the conflict doesn't ever break out. At least they know why they're there. I think they understand that it's related to the possibility of world peace and the possibility of a different type of world in the 21st century than we've enjoyed in the 20th century.
Do you still feel that you and Hollywood don't quite see eye to eye?
I think it's a kind of love-hate relationship. I mean, I genuinely adore a lot of people there, and I've got great friends, and a lot of them have been massively loyal to me. And there's others who I enjoy disliking, because they represent to me something to fight against. I'm sure Gazza would tell you the same thing. In life, it's very important sometimes to know who the opposition are and want to get round them.
Yeah. Does it encourage you? For instance, I suppose it's maybe only just a straw in the wind, but does it encourage you that somebody like My Left Foot can win Oscars?
Oh, enormously. And I think if you look back at the last 5 or 6 years of the Oscars, or right the way back to Chariots, there are always these extraordinary films that break out, that audiences fall in love with, that don't have stars in. And that I think once you establish those films in the hearts of the audience, they love you all the more for it. You know what I mean?
Hmm. Why have you not ever tried to direct? Have you got no visual sense or what?
I don't think it's that. I think the world actually is chock-a-block with mediocre directors, and it doesn't need an extra one.
Most actors want to become directors, producers surely. But I mean, don't you have a hand in the pie, really? You do have a creative input.
A couple of fingers in the pie. But I think, honestly, my nightmare, if I ever directed, would be I'd look at the first day's rushes and I'd want to fire myself. Now, I'm no masochist. I don't want to go through that. So I think I'd rather start off getting someone who's just much better than me.
Yes, it's a good movie, Memphis Belle. I hope it has the success it deserves. And it's good to see you back with your name associated with the movies.
Bless you. Thanks very much.
David Puttnam.
So thanks to David.
I wish Memphis Belle well, and of course Gaza, who we do wish well. And so we wend our weary way through hordes of still screaming Gaza maniacs outside, securing the knowledge that Wednesday's another day, and here in Shepherd's Bush Hall of Fame, we'll be meeting the star of King Kong. No, not the ginormous gorilla. The original lady in the palm of his hand, Faye Ray. A couple of birds of a feather, Pauline Quirk and Linda Robson, and a man who has survived 5 murder attempts by his wife. And she'll be here too. So he'll probably be in a suit of armor. So join us on Wednesday at 7. It should be good. See you then. Bye-bye. Thank you.